Hey guys, welcome back. Today we're going to be installing the Victron SmartShunt 500 amp. Alright, so Victron also does make a 1000 amp version, but why you would need 1000 amps, I would like to know. If you have a solar system that uses 1000 amps, please let me know. So why do you need a shunt? We use a shunt in solar systems to monitor the battery state of charge. Shunts have column counters. It actually counts the amp hours going in and out of the battery. You can also see how long the battery will last based on the given load. So LiPo 4 batteries have a very flat and steady voltage discharge curve. So your battery voltage will not fluctuate greatly during the pretty much 90% of its life cycle. The first 2% will drop quickly and then it'll stay there for the whole time until it hits to about 10%, and then that will drop quickly. So really you can't tell what's going on during that whole time. During the battery charge or discharge cycle. So that's why you need a shunt. The shunt also comes with a Bluetooth app, so you can monitor it with your phone. And that's a really cool feature. But you have to be pretty close to the shunt, within maybe 20 feet. Let's get started. All right, let's see what we got in the box. Instruction manual. The SmartShunt 500 amp. A power cable and an auxiliary power cable. So looking at the inverter, we can see the battery voltage is at 55 volts. And that's all the inverter really tells you. I consider 55 volts to be 100% fully charged on my battery. All right, just to show you the same shunt installed on my 24 volt system, just to show you what it looks like when it's hooked up. So the shunt has two terminals. It has a two battery minus, and this goes to your battery. And it has two system minus, and this goes to your loads or your inverter. The shunt always goes on the negative side. You'll never put it on the positive side. I've seen people actually try to do that, or suggested doing that. And then there's a power wire right here. This supplies power to the shunt. Once the shunt's installed, if you were to connect anything directly to the negative terminal of your battery, you would essentially be circumventing the shunt and defeating its purpose. The whole point of the shunt is to track everything coming in and out of the battery. So all your negative loads will go to the system minus. This essentially becomes your battery negative. So before you install your shunt, whatever you currently have connected to your battery minus, you will move all those connections to the system minus on your shunt. So before you install your shunt, you want to make sure to disconnect your battery from the system. Since the shunt needs to be installed to the main bus bar, we have to remove both negatives to our inverters and relocate them to the load or system minus on the shunt. Okay, so here's our shunt. We're going to install it like upside down like this, so that the battery minus is on this side, and it's going to loop around and connect to our main battery minus on our bus bar. I think this should be about a good spot. Okay, so a couple things to note. The bolts that come with the shunt, these are 3/8. The battery lugs that are commonly used on bus bars and battery connections are 5/16. So 5/16 is just a hair smaller than the 3/8. Yeah, I don't know why they decided to use 3/8. They could have used 5/16. I mean, even this bus bar, which is a 1000 amp bus bar, uses 5/16. So why Victron used the 5/3/8 bolts on these shunts is beyond me. Just make sure to clean all your bolts and your battery lug connections with isopropyl alcohol. So make sure you have a nice good connection. The third thing I want to mention, before you install the shunt, before you start the project, make sure your battery is fully charged. Whatever you define your 100% to be, make sure your battery is fully charged, because you're going to have to sync the shunt with the battery. A healthy bit of alcohol never hurt anybody. So remember, when making your connections, your battery cable and the lug needs to be directly against the bus bar. You don't want to have a washer or anything in between. So you want the lug right on the bus bar. This thing is crazy. Look how big that Phillips head is. Ouch. I didn't get shocked. I felt like it though. Actually, something cranked in my wrist. I'm just getting old. That's plenty tight enough. Okay. All right, so next we can connect our inverters to our system minus. Now we're going to be connecting two inverters, so we're going to have to do our connections like this. We're going to have to stagger them. But if you had more than three, I wouldn't do more than three connections on any sort of battery connection or any terminal connection for that matter. So if you had to do more than three, then you might want to consider getting the Lynx. There's a Lynx shunt that actually is built for this bus bar, and it connects right to these terminals here, and it goes right here. And that way you can have your entire bus running through the shunt, and it's designed for this. It looks very nice.
Let's take a quick look at the Victron Lynx power distribution system. The power in would be used for your battery or other power in components. All the loads would be connected to the Lynx distributor via fused connections. Finally, the Lynx shunt would be installed between the distributor and the power in bus bars. In this configuration, the shunt can track all the power going between the loads and batteries.
Looks dumb, but the connection is maximized. Okay, so the last thing we need to do is install our power cable to our shunt. So the shunt has power. So we're going to have to run this little cable from our positive bus bar over to the battery VBAT Plus. There's a small inline fuse inside this right here, so we're gonna have to just tuck that inside there. And this shunt uses very little power when it's at idle, and in fact it only uses 50 milliamps. But let's first plug it in. So this is gonna go right here. Be very careful when you're putting this in. It doesn't require much force, but it kind of just sticks in there. If you need to release it, there's a little orange tab, and you use a screwdriver and you push down on a tab, and it'll release this connector. Now we can put our bus bar cover back on. Now that the shunt is installed, before we power up the system, let's go ahead and configure the shunt. So you're going to want to download and install the Victron Connect app. That's the app Victron uses for pretty much all their equipment. It's nice. One app for all their hardware. You can go ahead and do two things. We want to tell the shunt how much capacity we have in terms of amp hours, and we want to also sync it to 100%. Our battery capacity. So it's actually 200 amp hours. I actually got it right. We're going to go to battery. The charge volt, we're going to say 55 volts. And the discharge floor, meaning how low, if you have a, say you're doing a 90-10, so you charge your battery up to 90%, and you discharge it down to 10%. So we want to set that floor to 10%. That's how the shunt will say when the shunt reads 0%, you'll actually be at the floor of 10%. So if you're doing a 10% bottom, the shunt will register 0%, but you'll actually have 10% remaining in the battery. That's just so you have a clean number. Charge efficiency should be 99. Put that at 99. So we're gonna go in here, we're gonna synchronize state of charge to 100%. So let's check our settings. Battery capacity, 200 amp hours, 55 volts is our 100% state of charge. Discharge floor is 10%. Per pew kit is 1.05. 99% charge factor. And let's see. If you don't charge your battery to 100%, which I do recommend you do, you can come in here and set your current state of charge. But how would you know it if you're just going off voltage, right? So that's why I recommend charging your battery to 100% so you know for sure that the battery is at 100% when you synchronize the shunt. The shunt has to have a reference, has to have a starting point. Okay, so how you read this is the current is 0.0 amps. So when you have a negative amp draw on your battery, when you're consuming power from the battery, this current value will read negative. When you have a surplus of power charging your battery, you're going to have a positive number. Your consumed amp hours, that just means out of 200 amp hours, we have 200 remaining because we're starting at the top and we're going to start drawing down the battery as soon as we turn on the system. And time remaining, that's our estimated remaining time at our current consumption. All right, so I got everything in the house plugged back in. So we're going to do a baseline test here and we're going to see what our draw is on the battery. And we're having a base draw of 700 watts. So at this rate, the battery would last 10 hours and 30 minutes. So my inverter is showing 150 watt draw, and we're getting 264 watt draw according to the shunt. So there's nothing else using the battery, so it's interesting that there's a discrepancy. Now that discrepancy could be from the conversion rate from the DC to the AC on the inverter. Oh yes, I discovered the discrepancy. So earlier I mentioned these inverters have a idle consumption rate of 60 watts. We have two inverters running, so that's 120 watts. That's right about where our discrepancy is right there. So I think that's our power. The inverter's not gonna report that, of course. See, the value of the shunt is already paying off. We wouldn't have noticed that otherwise. I fired up the gaming PC. We're going to turn on the mini split heat pump. That's why I haven't did a video, because I've been installing this thing and other stuff, but so far it's working really good. I'll do a video on that shortly. All right, so we got the heat pump going. We're gonna turn on a couple heaters. One heater and a heat gun. So this inverter says we're using about 900 watts. And this inverter says we're using 3 kilowatts. Now, just going off the inverter data, you would have to do some math to add the output of each inverter and get a total output. Well, the shunt does it all in one place. So we can quickly see on the shunt, without even having to go to the inverters, we can see that we're drawing 4,000 watts. Pretty cool, huh? At 4,000 watts, our battery would be dead in about three hours. About 6,000 watts, we're pulling over 6,000 watts. 120 amps on the battery. That's the most I've ever pulled. So the gaming PC, it was in Windows. I launched the game, and once it goes from Windows to actually running the game, the wattage goes from 300 watts in Windows to 800 watts running an actual game. And I turned on the toaster oven. So check it out, 6,000 watts. That's crazy. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.